I call this statutory and regular session of the Wetzel County Board of Education to order. We will start with the opening pledge led by Mrs. Nice, followed by a moment of silence. Anyone not wishing to participate may stay seated.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May be seated. So under the statutory meeting, the next thing is the approval of the 2024-2025 levy estimates and general current expense funds.
If you may, I'll expound on this just a little bit. So you have in front of you this that I dropped in front of you today. It is it's basically a five-year history of assessed values in Wetzel County. And if you go back, basically this is, you know, all of our tax, all of our revenue, basically. There are a few federal grants and state grants, but in the scheme of things, for the most part, the lion's share is our tax dollars now. Based on the assessed values that were certified, we are not going to receive any state aid next year. We knew that was coming. We were on the verge of it this year with our local tax collections being so high that they reduce our state aid share. So we're going to be there fiscal year 25 budget. But you can look at our history here. The very bottom line there kind of works backwards, but you will see that in fiscal year 22 and fiscal year 23, we took two hits to our assessed values. They dropped the percentage and then dropped another 9% the past couple years, not counting this year. And as you know, we just had a carryover budget meeting. We had to borrow to balance our budget because, when I say borrow, not borrow from an outside, borrow from ourselves from the next year to balance our budget in fiscal year 23 because we didn't have enough revenue to cover everything that we were doing. And then the year we're currently in, we had a 15% increase in assessed property values. So if you know how the assessed value property valuation works, you're kind of 2 years behind. So if you look at 2 years ago, what was oil and gas values like in 2 years ago? It was tremendously high. The year before last. So we've had 2 years of pretty good oil and gas. It's dropped a little now, so I expect a decrease coming. But you look at that number, and it's not a myth. There's an 87% increase in property values. The next year's budget, we will see that revenue next year. So we've been a little behind Tyler County. We've been a little behind Marshall County. And when you look at the map of Wetzel County, which I've shown you before, and there's a lot of untapped oil and gas in this county for some reason, but we're starting to catch up. So we will, these values are, we translate the assessed property values into what our expected revenue budget is. And that's what you have that I'm asking for approval for tonight. And we are looking at a significant increase in revenue for the next fiscal year. We'll drop our state aid completely, but we will see a significant increase in revenue. Again, I'm still early in the budgeting process, but we could see a significant increase of potentially $37 million increase in our revenue next year, which is unheard of, and it's about time that Wetzel County, we've seen what's happening out in our county, and we've seen some increases, but this is our first significant increase that we should see in fiscal year 25 for the next fiscal year. So I'm asking for approval. Thankful once again for the excess levy that our voters have passed. Since, I can't remember, what was that, Joe Beth? The 50s? Because of that, we're able to see this increase and hopefully do some wonderful things and continue to do some of the wonderful things for our students. But that's really all I have for you. You have this in front of you. I'll need a signature from Mrs. Porter, and then I will submit this. It'll be published in the newspaper for a couple weeks, and then we will come back and officially approve those on the third Tuesday as required by statute, third Tuesday in April.
And Mr. Langer, just for clarity's sake, and correct me if I say something that's mistaken.
Yes.
But we're basically just statutorily handling a procedural process of something the voters of Wetzel County have already approved.
Absolutely. And what the state legislature has approved on a regular levy, those percentages are already set, and our voters of Wetzel have already approved the excess levy rate. So that's it.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right. Do I have a motion to, well, I'll move to grant approval of the levy estimates and general expense funds for submission to the appropriate state agencies. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Flanner, seconded by Mr. Price. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. So this will be the recess of our statutory session. This is the vote for approval for resource of the statutory session until continuation of it on April 16th, 2024.
I move for the recess.
Been moved by Mr. Castillo. Is there a second? Seconded by Mrs. Nice. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. We are out of statutory session at 6:06. Now we're into our regular session. First thing on our regular session are the presentations. excuse me. First presentation are technology integration specialists.
And thank you for the opportunity to present to the board. At the end of January, three of our technology integration specialists and I attended FETC. So, of course, it turns into alphabet soup. What is FETC? FETC is the Future of Education Technology Conference, the leading conference for K-12 technology education, but it's not your average conference, as there were over 10,000 attendees. With admission, we had access to keynote speakers, literally hundreds of sessions. The very first session, when we looked at the agenda and had to decide, we had 35 options. Access to exclusive workshops, such as a 2-hour hands-on blended learning workshop, where we address the proper and effective use of technology in the classroom. Presenters had real-world experiences of incorporating technology into different learning models, as well as an expo with hundreds of vendors, innovative technology advancements, opportunities to meet one-on-one with users and providers, and experience those demos hands-on in person. Personally, I went with the following in mind. I wanted to learn more about the current products and services used by Wetzel County schools, get updates, put names with faces. I wanted to research about new products and the latest trends in K-12 technology education, as well as the needs for specific projects, such as the recording devices for the self-contained special ed restrooms that we'll have to install this summer. Also, continuing to streamline our current technologies. And just to stay on top of what's next in technology education. Tonight, I'm happy to have three of our technology integration specialists with us in person. Holly Kane, Candy Loy Kay, and Nikki Emsch. Unfortunately, our fourth, Heather Hale, was unable to be here due to medical reasons. However, she pre-recorded her portion of the presentation, which we will now watch.
Good evening. Sorry I cannot be there in person this evening. I wanted to take the opportunity to thank you for letting us attend FETC and for also purchasing the premium plan. This allowed us to attend sessions that weren't very crowded. I attended one session that was with the basic package, and it was for Microsoft Copilot. There was standing room only, and I was using a garbage can as a desk so I could follow along with the presentation. So I wanted to say thank you for that. I attended many sessions, enjoyed learning from all the presenters. One that stuck out to me and is important to me is the esports session. The presenters spoke about how esports is growing rapidly in the middle school and high school, and there are many scholarships that are available for these students that are participating. I know Magnolia in the past has been competed in numerous esports competitions, and their team was very successful. I am hopeful this continues and the program grows for our students. Esports offers another opportunity to be a part of a team for people, for students that maybe do not want to play in a physical sport. This teaches them teamwork and helps them develop their skills with, and helps them with problem solving, as well as being able to apply for scholarships that are available. Verizon, Minecraft, and Nintendo are a few companies that offer scholarships to students that play in esports and also are majoring in computer science. I've sent out a list to principals or counselors of other scholarships that I've compiled over the past few weeks for students that may want to apply. In the expo, one of the booths that I stopped at was promoting cyber.org. This is a free site through the government. This program aims to ensure that students have the fundamentals of cybersecurity and the skills and knowledge to pursue cybersecurity careers. This is an important career to explore in grades K through 12, and with our county implementing career exploration, this site offers many lessons and resources. I've created a tab inside of our Schoology page in case any teacher would like to access that. Some of the subjects that are covered are career and technical education, computer science, cybersecurity, engineering, humanities, math, robotics and coding, and also science.
Okay, now I'll turn it over to Canva.
One of the sessions that stuck out to me was Canva. So Canva is a graphic design platform that allows users to create a wide range of visual content like videos, presentations, worksheets, and business materials for the simulated workplace. Canva is a free online platform for students and teachers, and all students and teachers have free access to all of the content. That includes pre-made lessons and projects for teachers, graphics and elements to enhance the project for both teachers and students. So students can use Canva to make things like a brochure or a PowerPoint as part of an assignment. But teachers also have access to tons of free templates that have content from preschool to 12th grade. So I have one example up in the top corner that was a pre-made PowerPoint that a teacher can get on Canva, and if that's their subject matter that they're going to teach, then they can tweak it to their classroom or their student needs for the day. So Canva can also be used to present lessons and content for teachers, and then students use it as a creation platform. So in the corner you'll see, looks like a minion face. So we used Canva, Heather, Hale, and I did a fourth grade tech day at Martinsville School, and we plan to visit the other fourth grades in the county. So as you can see in the picture, the first picture are students using QR codes. They had to work out long division problems, and then they used a QR code to check the answer themselves. Then they also got to visit Africa or Asia in the VR goggles. They played with the unruly splats, and we also had the VEX robots available, and then there was a session for Canva. So in the middle at the bottom is what the students see as the Canva platform. And they, so it's basic design and the use of Canva to create the minions. So they had to insert, they had to come up with that they needed a postcard, and then they had to make the background yellow. And then as they went, they just had to build the elements to make it look like the minion. And that's an example of one of the student created minions in the class. Now I'm turning it over to Holly.
Before I start, this is a personal thing for me. 2 days from now is Pi Day, so happy Pi Day, everybody. have some pie, 3.14, show your nerdy side on Thursday. So when I go to these conferences, I always have to have a plan in mind. Because the first conference I went to, I was so overwhelmed. I was like, I don't think I got what I could out of it. So I wanted to see Canva, and Candy already presented on that. And so the other one is AI. Because last year at FETC, it was like you had to stand in line to get into any session that had AI in it. I was like, okay, I'm gonna do that. I went this year, it was even bigger. Everybody was talking about AI. It was almost hard to find a session that didn't have some kind of AI component to it. So we're gonna do a little interactive thing here. So I'll keep it in the interactive things. The statistics say 75% of people have never used AI. So raise your hand if you've never used AI. Okay? So put your hand down. Keep them up. Put your hand down if you've never used Siri or Alexa. So if you've ever used, or if you've ever used Siri or Alexa, your hand goes down. Your voice recognition, whenever anybody gets tired of typing, so you just talk into your phone for it, that's AI. Social media, have you ever watched a cow hoof trimming video and all of a sudden all of them are house trimming, you know, maybe that's just me, but something else, and all of a sudden that's all you see, that's AI looking at what you see, and then all of a sudden it's everywhere. And you're like, I want to stop watching these videos, how about you stop? Anytime you use GPS, anytime you do a Google search, that's all AI. So you're thinking, what is the big deal? We've been using this stuff for decades. So the difference is that before it was all data, statistics, facts, using that information to do stuff. Now we have generative AI, artificial intelligence. So this is where I have Skynet and the Terminator 2, because this is how Terminator 2 starts. Okay, because Skynet's going to take over the world, and who knows what's going to happen. So this is the new part. It's actually starting to think. It's creative. It's actually doing stuff. So for example, if you go to ChatGPT, which is the most famous one right now, you type in, write a 10-page essay about Pride and Prejudice. And within minutes, you'll have it done. Bam. And you type in again, I want you to do, write the whole thing over again, but write it on a 10th grade level. So it looks like a 10th grader wrote it. Boom. Done. A couple minutes. So and your students know how to do this. Even if you've never done it, your kids are already using it. The problem is, I just did a training at Magnolia, where we talked about AI. 75% of them had never even heard of it, had never used it. And I'm like, I guarantee your kids are using it. And if you don't know what it is, how are you going to fight that plagiarism? Right? How are you going to make sure they're actually learning it, not just typing it in? So that's the difference. It's just now a more creative thing. And it's, like I said, it's everywhere now. We need to get, the big takeaway I got from all my sessions is, we need to get ahead of this and make sure we as Wetzel County Schools have an idea of how we're going to handle this. Make sure teachers know about it. Know how to combat it in the students' use. Teach the students how to use it appropriately. And then also make sure the teachers are using it for themselves. Like, I'm getting stuff ready for Pi Day. And I was like, give me 20 jokes about them for Pi Day. Bam, 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 bam. And it helped me instead of searching, doing it. I could have done that, but it saved a bunch of time. So the ones that are most prevalent at FETC were OpenAI, ChatGPT, which was famous. Microsoft Copilot, I just did a training on that. So, and this person put out a great step-by-step for all the teachers so they can use it. Magic AI, Magic School, and CuraPod are ones designed specifically for teachers. Especially CuraPod is for making presentations. So AI is almost everywhere, like any program you have. We just talked about Canva. Canva has magic, and they call it, but it's AI. That's all it is AI. PowerSchool, which is the school and stuff, that's all I got. So that's my big takeaway. And then, so this is just real quick, just for me specifically, what FETC was for me. I had 20 plus hours of continued education credit. They usually started at 8. I didn't get on the bus until 6 at night. A couple times I told me, I said, I forgot to eat lunch today, because I didn't want to miss a session. So, believe it or not, I missed lunch. So, the two sessions that really stood out, because I could talk forever, AI Classroom, which we talked about a little ago, and Hacker Coaching. Hacker Coaching was really great about someone doing my job, how can you make it better? And it actually inspired me to, like, what do I do that I can share with other people in this job? And so I did an SREB proposal, and it got accepted because, we met over 60 vendors. Like she said, there's hundreds of them. I can tell you 60 of them specifically that I have an in-depth conversation with. And half of them are current ones that we have right now that I learned stuff from. Like I went to a program we had called Lucid, and they said, hey, you have to turn on the AI. Did you know that? Is that turned on? I said, I don't know. I'll go check right now. And I would never have known to check if it wasn't for them talking to me. Another great one is Trafera, which those are laptops, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, I went and talked to them for a little bit, because I knew they were a vendor of ours, and on all the teachers' computers, there's Trafera Trails. It's a curriculum that they give out to all of us for free, because we work with them. It's all online, but I talked to them and said, here, have this physical book. You actually can't buy this anywhere, so we're going to give it to you. and the author signed it for me, and she gave me her business card, and now whenever I read it with the kids, we're set sometimes to read it with the kids, she's going to do a Skype with me or a Zoom call, and so the kids are actually going to get to meet the author of the book they're reading in class, which I thought was really cool. And then Power School, which runs Schoology, anybody who knows me knows Schoology's my baby. I talked to them, they saw my excitement for Schoology, and they asked me, can you come present at our conference this summer? And they said, can you sign up to be one of our champions? And I was like, heck yeah. And then last, 25 pounds of swag. You think, how do you know it was 25 pounds? Because that's how much more of my luggage weighed on the way back through. And what did I do with it? I gave a lot of it away at the teacher PL day that we had. I gave some to Ned Heeks, and she didn't get to go. And then I gave away student prizes. They will like lose their mind if you give them a little squishy thing. So I got a bunch of those. And then, just so the board would feel left out, I brought some swag for you, too. And if you guys want any swag, just let me know.
$5, right?
And then this is some pictures of me with Sarinda Swan at BCC. This was our keynote speaker. I got to meet him. I got his book for free, which is like a tech Bible, and I've used it a lot since we've gotten back. So, okay. And then what have I done? These are things that I specifically have done because of effort at BCC. From then until now, I've actually done this in the classroom. These are direct correlations between us going to BCC and now. So I did some Canva lessons, including all the AI tools. Read over the WVEVE AI guidance, which is a lot. That's a 30-page document. So because I knew more about AI, I could dive into it. Reevaluated some vendors, talked to Mrs. McPherson. We're going to expand some, but reduce others. It's all about streamline. I did a 3-hour training. I asked them 75% had never used AI. But that day, nobody left without knowing what AI is. I used Copilot for a Beginning Teachers Academy activity that we did. And we did some learning.com lessons, and we've done some Tech Tuesdays. We're going to do a Tech Tuesday devoted to learning.com. And if you want to know more about learning.com, gotcha. Thank you, everyone. So I'm walking through this giant expo, and we have all split up to find the best of the best. And they run up to me so excited, saying, you have to go and find the learning.com booth. Once I was there, I talked to one of the people at the booth and told them I'm from West Virginia, and they immediately stopped their spiel. They pulled out a list, and they said, what county? Told them Wetzel County, and they're like, ah, you're on our list. And then they filled me in that the Mountain State Educational Services Cooperative has a digital literacy program, and they provided a grant that covers the cost associated with learning.com. Now, this is now available to all schools that serve students grades K through 8. Immediately, I signed Wetzel County up, worked with those on the site, and by the next morning, all 4 grade schools and Payton City High School were ready to utilize learning.com through our Clever platform. So being there in person gave us that. First off, had no idea it existed, but then being able to work with that company directly gave us that step up. Learning.com covers different topics: computational thinking, coding, computer fundamentals, multimedia, online safety and digital citizenship, keyboarding, typing, internet usage and communications, and spreadsheets and databases. Let's move to the next slide. We're going to pass it off to Nikki, who has actually taken all of this information and ran with it.
So yeah, as it was alluded to, I volunteered to stay back just to kind of have some boots on the ground. I have been working with several teachers, allowing me to come into their classroom and kind of integrate and help them with some technology. Learning.com is kind of like a one-stop shop that has a lot of things that are under one umbrella. You go in and you can find a lot of different lessons already pre-made and ready to roll for teachers. There is a side, which I have a couple videos on here, and I will apologize. I have been working with Mrs. Roethlisberger at Payton City Elementary in her pre-K classroom. I've been coming in throughout the entire year and become a part basically of her stations to help her integrate the technology a little bit more easily. So I will say, compared first semester, I had to find the resources myself. I kind of had to find the thing that would be used. This second semester, these guys have kind of made my job a little bit easier because there's a lot of things that are held within learning.com that has allowed me to help. And I really appreciate the pre-K allowing me to come in, because if we start them off on the right foot and build this positive experience with technology, we can use it as a tool and kind of have it, you know, something that we, you know, can benefit us. So my first video, it highlights the Tech Quest, which is the student-led and student-driven lessons. This is a pretty long video, but I wanted to highlight. And as you can hear, the wonderful chaos that goes on in the pre-K classroom. The lessons are engaging. They start them off, and this is a pre-K student working with me. Her name is Miss Charlotte. And you can see Mrs. Roethlisberger sitting there with her. But what it does is it walks them through, this is keyboarding specific, it walks them through individual keys. If you watch the kind of pictures and the feedback that the students get from this program, they're very, very engaged in it. If you can hear, like I said, there's a lot of chaos, a lot of fun things happening around them, but they still wanted to come and sit with Miss Nikki and Miss Carly and work on their technology skills. So it walks them through first by having that keyboard up there, and it shows them where the location of the letters are. The second part of the lesson moves them on to more independent. So they covered in this lesson A, B, C, and D. So they work their way through those. And then at the very end, they had two slides that had a fill in the blank. So they had to have that first letter of each sound. Okay, and you can kind of see a little astronaut coming across there. D had the dinosaur, and it made some great roars. We got to talk about how we love dinosaurs. But the feedback in these lessons are very good. And then whenever you, I didn't want to have to play the entire video. This next one highlights the arcade side of things. So just kind of similar to iReady, they have those structured lessons, but then at the same time, they have those breaks and the ability to earn time in the arcade. So this specific game is called Keyboard Garden. And I showed you a student who was at the medium level. At the easiest level, they just give them the individual letters. And there is, throughout the game, there's some rewards that come up, like you were helping Miss Bunny grow her garden. And so right now, the student had a green pepper that had been grown. And it has the option to learn a little bit more, and of course, the kids want to. So it goes over and gets them a little bit of information about that vegetable or whatever they grew that day. And they get really, really excited for that. And like I said, it is leveled, so like your students who maybe are a little bit lower, we can keep them at the easy level, but then we can also challenge our students who excel a little bit. I really like that individualization with it. And then the fact that they have the student-driven side of lessons where it's graded within it, and then they also have this teacher discussions that go along with it. So there's a lot of options. I also like the fact you can add in your own lessons. On the keyboarding and the adaptive keyboarding, I can add in my own guided lesson. So let's say that we're working on, you know, World War II right now. Within that thing for our keyboarding lesson for that day, I can put in a paragraph about World War II to help them kind of reinforce what we're learning. So that, yes, it has been a very good platform to help, especially with technology.
And then in addition to the actual, you've seen the actual program there, on the teacher side, there's data. So you can see there's just two examples there based on what the TISIS have done so far, that 130 students have been active on learning.com. And on the right, it shows, it actually has more information, student name, classroom, the teacher specific, how many total minutes, exercises completed, their accuracy with the typing. That's what this specific piece of data.
And mind you, that data is just from basically February and this 2 weeks in March, because they brought it back at the end of January. So we've seen some good engagement.
Okay. That's it from us.
Well,
any questions?
It was very enlightening, and it made me sit here thinking, I wish I was still in the classroom. So thank you very much. Anybody else have any comments they'd like to make?
I do appreciate the thought that we got to get ahead of AI, because we do have to get ahead of AI.
We do.
And it's not going to be easy, but
it's going to be for teachers and students.
Everybody.
For teachers, students, everybody.
Yeah.
Parents.
Personally.
definitely in the financial world, that's something we're fighting too. So
yeah.
I know trying to stay ahead, and so teachers know what to look for, that is huge. And I think that's awesome that there was that many vendors, that many opportunities and topics to hit. That's, and there's gonna be more. It's awesome.
Thank you.
This will be in all the classrooms, all the schools.
So
with
right
teacher, with a teacher there.
So right now that's, so technology integration specialists, their job is to go in and work with classroom teachers and show them all of this technology, how it works, and how to integrate that into their classroom. So that's our game plan, is to hit as many classrooms as we possibly can before the end of the school year. Like I said, we got, you know, it was mentioned, we started in February with this specific program with that learning.com. So the TISs are available to any Wetzel County school teacher. If they have a question, if they have an idea of something they'd like to do in their classroom, but they're not 100% sure, you know, like how am I going to, you know, integrate technology into this? There's a form that they can fill out online, and one of the TISs answers the call and sails out.
So you'll physically go into the classroom?
Yes,
yes.
Yes, physically in the classroom,
with
working
the
side by side with the teacher.
With the teacher.
And the students, yes.
Yeah, like the day that we did the fourth grade tech day at New Martinsville School, Mrs. Hale and I were there, but then we also used the classroom teachers to have different stations, so there are like regular teachers and the TISs working together.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Our next item coming up is delegations, and before we start our delegations, and I do, excuse me if I keep coughing, I'm just trying to get healthy. I want to go over the guidelines for how we do delegations so no one is confused about what it is. Each person will have 5 minutes to speak of the people that are registered, and the clock will come on letting you know where you are in those 5 minutes. Do not be upset if the board members don't respond. We are not allowed by law to respond to delegations. We have to sit here and listen, and we take it in. And if it's brought up on a future agenda for something to happen, we have that knowledge base to share and use. But at the time that a delegation speaks, we may not reply to you. And I know that's tough. It's tough for me sitting here not to. All comments are to be made to the board, not to the audience. Comments are not to be of a personal nature. Not saying that you can't talk about how it's affecting you or your area or something, but not that it's like slamming or attacking me or something like that. And the board is not responsible for the speaker's comments. The speaker's completely responsible for his or her own comments. So with that being said, our first delegation person is Mayor Chip Goff from the 100 area. Feel free to stand at the podium or without it, that's up to you.
Good evening, members of the board. As she said, I am Mayor Hunter, Chip Goff, also a proud alumni of Hunter High School. And today I'm here in support of Hunter High School, as the community has been hearing of some rumors, and we have lots of concerns about Hunter High School. So I'd like to take this opportunity to talk about community impact, the student impact, business impact, and school impact. Some recent decisions by the Board of Education are affecting course offerings, staff positions, and student opportunities. We hear of consolidation possibilities for Hunter High School, and just wanted to be noted that geographically that's just not a good option for Hunter to consolidate. If it's in the thinking that our students would come to New Martinsville, they have other options that are closer, such as students can go to Cameron and Marshall County, they could go to Clay Battelle and Mon County, they could go to North Marion and Marion County, and they could even cross state line if they're allowed and go to Green County to go to West Green High School. Our concerns are if our high school closes, it's going to affect our grade school as well. It's going to affect our community. It's going to affect staff. So we have a lot of concern. We here today that's gathered, you know, we love our community. We love our high school. We love the history of it. And we don't want to see that end. Just as Payne City fought over the years for their school, we're here to fight for our school as well. We want to ask you to help us make our school attractive and attract, get more people to it. We don't want to lose more students. We want to get more students here. You know, currently we have positions that are not being posted. They're empty, and we have teachers that have so much more to offer than just teaching core classes all day. They're very gifted teachers and have a lot to offer. You know, we hear of our programs such as business, our funky floors, maybe the Cover Bridge Bakery, even our robotics program, maybe moving to Martinsville. To us, it's upsetting. You know, our students have put a lot of work into these programs, and with great advisement from their teachers and dedication, and we'd hate to see these programs lost. It affects our community as well. These are businesses. They support our community. And the kids have fought hard, and they deserve to get to keep these programs in our school. Also, I think, in my own opinion, you know, it'd be cheaper if you had interested students in our programs that we have initiated at Hunter High School with our funky floors or our Cover Bridge Bakery, or even how our robotics program has become so elite and nationally known. I think that, you know, it'd be cheaper to bus students to our school than to close our programs and relocate them and start them clear over. You know, these programs I speak of, you know, they serve not just the Hunter community, but our surrounding communities. We're right on the border of so many counties, and they all come to Hunter every day. Also, we've created a special bond with our high school students and staff in the community. They go above and beyond the students. With getting grants, they've been, you know, they build a replica of Henry Church cabin, you know, they built a theater, and it's just great to see the students so involved in our community, and we just want to keep them in our community and keep them with the helping Hunter to come back and grow. I just ask that if our positions that are empty at this time, our positions, if you could please fill those, bid them, give our teachers a chance to fill those positions. You know, there's a lot of advantages of a small school. The students can talk to the teachers if they have home problems, and sometimes it's life changing to be able to help the kids save their life. Like I said, I've been out of school for 33 years, and also still to this day, from going to Hunter High School, I still have a lot of respect for all my teachers, all the staff there currently. I still call all my teachers Mr. or Mrs. I still call my coaches. And I believe that I wouldn't be today, a boss of every day, a mayor, a dad, a grandpap, if it wasn't for the teachers that shaped me personally. So to please put an end to the rumors and to please help us save our school. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Okay. Our next person to speak is Karen Longwell.
Good evening. My name is Karen Longwell. Over the past few years, I've become concerned that Hunter High School has lost teaching positions and course offerings. When a teacher bid out or went into a different career path, the county administrative staff would decide not to fill the positions or provide the course offerings. One in particular, our broadcast and our podcast, our business program. When Mr. Couch left, it left, they didn't fill it. I watched your meeting discussions about mergers and consolidations with even deeper concern for 100 High School. Rumors about the future of 100 High School are swirling. So you can guess what this causes, how this causes increased concerns of the future of the school, low morale, stress, and staff members having one foot out the door looking for jobs in neighboring counties or Pennsylvania. Teachers and staff that have been dedicated to the 100 communities for years are being affected emotionally. Staff members and students feel unsure about their future at 100 High School. They feel isolated and that they are not important to Wetzel County Schools. By not communicating directly and openly the clear goals for the high school and how the goals benefit the students and staff, and I'm giving you the benefit, you have unintentionally hurt students and staff morale at 100 High School. And now it forwards into the communities in the 100 area. You have recognized the accomplishments of 100 High School students and teachers for their Technology Student Association Awards and innovations for years, as well as the many students that have achieved academically to continue their education. Clearly, this left good impressions, and now decisions about two of our TSA CTE programs from 100 will be offered 28 miles from our small local high school in order to grow the Wetzel County Tech Center. So we wonder and pause to consider, will two more positions be lost at 100 High School? Why eliminate? Why not reinvent the curriculum electives to provide exploratory studies for 8th grade through 10th grader students instead of eliminating them altogether? There are many CTE technical education programs that could be offered at the County Tech Center. That wasn't the decisions. Why not expand programs to automotive mechanics, auto body repairs, HVAC, plumbing, hairstyling? There are so many courses that could be offered that would not be feasible at each individual high school, and you wouldn't be able to purchase that equipment. We are not against progress. Growing the tech center is great, but it does not have to be at the expense of our existing courses and staff at 100 High School. With changes in curriculum offerings and underlying rumors of mergers and consolidations from Wetzel County School Administration, our high school is receiving internal effects that cause our students and teachers to leave Wetzel County. Rather than evaluate our small high school with a narrow focus on enrollment or building capacity, which often perpetuate inequities, we call on you to judge our high school on its civic and social purposes and the significant impact it has in our small local community. It provides three businesses to our community. We urge you, the Board of Education, to think creatively about the social, mental, and physical health support that our small high school provides every day to the students and the community surrounding 100. We urge you to ask your administrative staff members to show you their curriculum plan for all students in detail and to include all of us as stakeholders in their decisions to close programs and positions. Open conversations about the plan should occur. 100 High School is a unique community school that has an immense value to our small town's vitality, and our small town provides immense value and support to the students. Talk to our community, convince us with transparency that you have a well thought out plan for the county that includes 100 High School.
Thank you. Okay, now Rachel Amos.
Good evening, my name is Rachel Amos. I come to you in regards to my concerns of my daughter going to the high school, and I also have three grandchildren that are just now entering the school system. We have recently relocated from Texas. I'm originally from Morgantown. I'm a University High graduate and very proud of my school, despite the fact that Morgantown High is the only one that anybody talks about. Now, that being said, I have been through issues with my daughter. She was very excited about coming to school. When we left Texas, COVID killed her school. All the students in all the schools down in Houston, Texas, Pasadena, the whole greater Houston area, were a year behind in all their education. We came up here and my daughter was like, I pulled them out of school. I was homeschooling them because they were not getting anything from their teachers, not via back home with schooling, not even when they were doing the blend it and then trying to take them back into the classrooms. They weren't getting it. I pulled my daughter and then I pulled my son. When I made the decision after my husband's passing to move up here with my four of my kids and my three grandkids, my daughter said, I want to go back to school, Mom. 17, she enrolled back in the 100 High School. And for once, she was excited about going back to school. And what it was the curriculum they offered. The smallness of it, she finally understood math again because the teacher has that time to sit there and teach her the math because her classroom is so small. She was lost in their big campus schools because there were more than 2,000 students just at her high school alone. And that wasn't even the biggest one in the area. And she had to walk. If you were within 2 miles, you had to walk. There is no bus system. You had to pay exorbitant fees just to even join any kind of curricular activity. You had to try out for band. You had to pay $500 if you wanted to be a cheerleader. You didn't understand what they do down there. There's classroom usage fees. They just kill people down there. In fact, I had to pay $300 just to get her transcripts for what she owed for just her year and a half attendance. So she's making up her school, and she's been very happy and proud of the fact that she's been going there. And even though she's going to be 19 graduating next year, she's happy with it. She's finally getting what she wants. She loved the cooking class. She signed up as soon as she could because it got to teach her business economics. Now, all the things that she was experiencing, I was like, great, this perfect for my grandkids as they come up through. Because this is what my son wanted for them because he dropped out of high school. He ended up getting his GED because he didn't like the schools down there. We left, we were living in Salem, and my kids were going to Mountaineer Middle and Liberty High. I had almost all three of my kids that got transferred down there drop out just because of the way the schools were being too big, being consolidated, and not caring exactly what they're doing. Yeah, they had a lot more opportunities. My son got to do a photography class and online stuff. But that was one teacher who they eliminated his position and the class was gone. I see the same thing happening here, and I don't want to see that happen to 100. I'm concerned about the people not being replaced when the position is empty, and I'm very concerned about the lack of diversity in the curriculum. UHS might have been smaller than MHS, but we offered a good curriculum. And even though we didn't have four different languages to learn, we still had two good solid ones. One teacher taught two until we got another teacher, and then I took her. But you know what? We stayed small. There was only 168 in my graduating class. And even half of those students, I don't even know where they're at anymore. I don't know most of my classmates. I can go to Morgantown now, and I don't even run into half the people I know because they all left. And I understand it's because of the economy here, but I also understand that this is my home and most of them wish they could come back. You want to keep your students here, you need to also sit there and look at the impact. If you're keeping the diversity, you need to make sure you do it in the small schools. You don't need to be closing any of the small schools and try to consolidate them. That's not going to sit there and grow anything. Students can come up with some programs. The robotics is a very good one from what I've heard. And I want my son, or my grandson, and my granddaughters to have the opportunities and the ability to go, hey, I want to try out for football, and I don't have to sit here and fight with everybody just to be able to try to participate. And that's what I want for my grandkids, for their future. And we made the decision to move to 100 because of what we saw online and because of my brother having his stepkids go through here after transfer from Marion County. So this is what I am asking. Please address the concerns and the staffing issues, and please do not take any more of the curriculum. We really need some of that back other than just four classes. And busing out to here for the tech center, that's a little bit long. It takes too much of their day.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you. I said, we are not allowed legally to respond at this time. Okay, so that was delegations. Next thing on the agenda, superintendent's information.
No report this
evening. No report? Okay, then we're under superintendent's recommendations. The first thing is approval of minutes from the regular meeting on February 27th, 2024, and the special meeting on March 4th, 2024.
Move for approval.
Been moved by Mr. Kassler for approval of minutes. Second?
Second.
Seconded by Mrs. Nice. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Next, under B, personnel matters, we have retirements, resignations, professional personnel, leave of absence. Do I have a motion to approve those personnel matters?
I move.
It's been moved by Mr. Glasscock. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been seconded by Mrs. Nice. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Next is the ratification of the superintendent's recommendation. This is consideration, possible action, and or amendment on the superintendent's recommendation that the following be ratified by the board. One, a service employee's paid and unpaid suspension, and two, a professional employee's paid suspension.
I move for executive session.
Mr. Castleman moves for us to go to executive session. Is there a second? There's a second under discussion. This is discussion of personnel matters, which code 6-9A-4B-2-A allows us to go into executive session for personnel matters. All those in favor of going into executive session, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. We go into executive session at 6:51. We're back in session, regular session at 7:10. We left executive session with Mr. Price making the motion to leave it. Mrs. Nice seconded it. It was agreed upon unanimously, and we left executive session at 7:09. Okay. Under ratification of superintendent's recommendation, the first one. Do you have a recommendation for us?
I do. Madam President, I recommend that the board ratify the paid and unpaid suspension for Virginia Morris.
I move that we uphold the superintendent's recommendation. Is there a second?
I second.
Seconded by Mr. Price. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Second one?
Madam President, at this time I recommend the initial paid suspension for investigative purposes be ratified by the board for Paul E. Barkus III.
Is there a motion to recommend this paid suspension for investigation?
So move.
So moved by Mr. Glasscock. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mrs. Nice. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Next, move on to routine matters. First one is approval request to attend Wetzel County Schools for the remainder of the school year submitted. It is one person that is wanting to come to Wetzel County Schools. Chaperones and volunteers, all of which have been vetted correctly.
Correct.
Correct. Thank you. Out-of-state trips, work release, a memorandum of agreement with Glendale State University and the Tech Center, and use of facilities for the Ramp Festival. Do I have a motion for approval of superintendent's recommendations as outlined under routine matters?
So moved.
So moved by Mr. Castillo. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mrs. Nice. Any discussion? I just want to say I'm glad to see that we're getting involved with Glendale, work with our students. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, treasurer's report.
I have a couple things for you. First, I'm asking for approval for payment of bills for the month of February, which you have in your packet. That's item A. Item B, I'm asking for approval for transfers and increases to the budget. I have a little of both. The one budget supplement that I have is $70,262. That's a high-cost, high-acuity special education grant. Something several counties don't even go after this money. It's something I started years ago. In this county, it is for those special education students that cost, the number varies a little bit, but it's around $30,000 to $40,000 that individually cost for care is that. They had one-on-one aids, that sort of thing. There's a grant you can go after. And so I started that years ago. Then me and Star Brick has worked on it. And then me and Christy Shriver worked on it. And then Christy Shriver has kind of taken it over. And she does a good job with that. So this grant is split between a federal grant. The federal portion is $27,629, and the state portion is $42,633. Total, a little over $70,000 that'll go towards reimbursement for some of our vision and services, some of the vision and PT and OT and all of that. So I'm thankful for that. And then the other item is the large transfer of $9,595,469.01. That follows up what we talked about in our budget carryover work session. This is just transferring those line that one line item that we put it in initially in contingency or reserve for future projects, and we're moving it into the line items for expenditure as we talked about. That's all that I'm asking for this evening.
So this is for approval for transfers and increases in budget and for payment of the bills for February of 2024. Do I have a motion to approve the treasurer's report?
I approve the treasurer's report.
Okay, Mrs. Nice, is there a second?
Second.
I'll second it. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, board member committee reports. Nothing for this time? Okay. Under other items, anything, anybody? Anybody's anything else? Under other items. Okay, then the date and the time of the next meeting will be March 26th. It's a regular meeting at 6 p.m. and it will be held at Valley High School. Do I have a motion for adjournment?
So
moved. Moved by Mrs. Nice. Is there a second?
I second.
Second by Mr. Price. All those in favor of adjournment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. We are adjourned at 7:15.